But God has also given us what? Promises regarding the circumstances that come to defeat us or to destroy us. God has given us a word that if we would turn to Him, trust Him, that He would deliver us out of our circumstances, negative circumstances. So He said, if I look at and I accept the circumstances as they are, I'll die in this well. But if I reject the circumstances and accept the word of God as a way out, He said, I'll have what? I'll be delivered. All right, that's what He was actually saying. So that's true for us today, that if we're going to agree with our circumstances, there's not going to be any what? Deliverance. Because when you agree with your circumstances, especially if they contradict God's word, then you're going to what? You're going to forsake God's what? God's mercy. All right, so I like that. That would be a good philosophy for us to live by. God has given us promises, and when the circumstances contradict those promises and those provisions and those blessings that God has promised us, then what? We can call them what? You a lie. Yes. Sickness, you a lie. Amen. Amen. So you can't receive mercy if you accept the circumstances. You gotta understand that circumstances are what? Lying what? Vanities. If God has given you a word, if there is a promise from God, you can bank on that. But circumstances are always what? Changing. All right.
I think I just had a revelation.
All right, give it to
us. Oh, as I look back over these verses, and now you, Jonah was cognizant of being there. Because it goes down all of the verses of read. Mm-hmm. It talks about then I said and all that. He was in his right mind. Mm-hmm. He knew all of this. Mm-hmm. But he didn't begin to make a turn until verse 7, mm-hmm. at least it says there, when his soul fainted. And often that's when we begin to make a turn. You know, we mm-hmm. all of those things that happen and everything. And then when we get to the point where it's like, okay, God, I give up. I can't. And you know, here I am. That's when his soul fainted, then he began to.
He remembered the Lord.
He remembered the Lord.
He began to pray.
Yeah, when his soul fainted.
Mm-hmm. Okay. That was your revelation?
Yeah, sometimes the soul have to faint before you remember the Lord.
All right. Y'all like that revelation?
Amen.
That's pretty good?
Yeah.
I mean, it's something new.
All right, anybody else got a revelation on that? That's a scripture that is commonly used when many times we are exhorting people to reject the circumstances if you have a word from God on it. Because as long as you what submit to the circumstance, you're not going to get no help from God. So you either reject the circumstances and turn to the word and call those circumstances lying vanities, or what? You lose the benefit of what God has what promised you or provided you through his redemption plan. So that's what that scripture means. Okay, now here's what the ninth verse, but I will sacrifice unto thee with the voice of thanksgiving. I want somebody to open that up. I will sacrifice unto thee with the voice of thanksgiving. I don't think he could offer an animal sacrifice down in there in the belly of a whale.
No. Well, it's kind of self-explanatory, isn't it? He was sacrificed unto thee with the voice of thanksgiving.
All right.
That
okay.
means that in the midst of all of that that's described up there,
okay.
He's going to will to thank God.
Okay.
In the midst of all of that.
Well, is it appropriate to thank God before God acts, though?
Yes.
That's what he said.
All right. That's what you call the sacrifice, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I want y'all to get this tonight. I've said this probably 25 times. The sacrifice of thanksgiving is always an act of expressing thanks for what you're believing God to do. That's before the answer what come before the thing is manifested. And it's a whole lot of power in that. Now, if you, all of these scriptures that we're going to be looking at tonight are kind of based on that, because before Joshua experienced the fall of Jericho, the walls fell, what did they do?
They marched around.
Praise God.
All right, they marched around how many times?
Seven.
And the seventh day they marched around what?
Seven.
And what were they doing?
Praising God.
All right. Now, that showed you that they offered the sacrifice. They praised the Lord for what? Their deliverance before what? The deliverance came. And they expressed that by giving thanks. Amen. And remember last week we started on Jehoshaphat, how they defeated those nations that had come against them. They were outnumbered, I believe, many times, 3-1, 10-1, I'm not sure. But anybody can recall exactly how Jehoshaphat and his army came out victorious as a result of them offering the sacrifice of thanksgiving. Anybody remember how that went?
They put the praises in front of his army. Then he put his praises in front of his army as they marched in battle.
All right, he put his singles on the front line. All right,
so Sharon and all of them—they were on the front line.
All right, suppose the singles are scared.
On the front line.
All right, suppose the singles are scared. That's what the Thanksgiving is designed to do. The Thanksgiving is designed to eliminate any kind of fear or anxiety, any kind of hang-up, anything that will prevent you from believing is to eliminate that factor so your faith can work. All right, now, here is what this little book here says. By giving thanks, we are able to focus on God's provision rather than our problems and distasteful circumstances. So that's exactly what Jonah had to do. He had to get his mind, what? Completely off of the circumstances that he was in. And it's difficult, y'all can tell me, it's difficult to get your mind off of your circumstances and problems, especially when they are pretty intense. And but as long as your faith is on your what? Problems, your faith cannot what? Work. Okay, so you have to find a way to get your attention away from your problems and get them eliminated from your what? From your heart, your mind, so that your faith can really what? Do what it needs to do. And the best way, that's the reason why Joshua and them marched around there seven times. Because Jericho was a big deal. I mean, they had some real fearful people that they were coming against. And that was a big nation. Israel, just a small nation at that time.
And it was a very well-fortified city.
Yeah, it was well-fortified. So by them marching around seven times, that began to what eliminate what? The fear, the anxiety, all of the tension and the frustration, and I don't see how this is going to do any good, you know, and all of the doubt and hindrances. And once you get your focus off of the problem and get them on God's ability, then that's when you open the door for God to work. Amen. So that is one of the primary reasons why we need to give thanks in the midst. The scripture says, in everything, do what?
Give thanks.
Give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you.
So you're saying then that thanksgiving and praise cannot coexist with fear.
Right.
Not effectively.
Yes, when you begin to praise and give thanks, then the fear and all of the hindrances that's going to interfere with your faith, that's when they're going to be dissipated or destroyed. See, If we had known that way back, we would have been much further along, right?
So Pastor Hill, in getting to that area, is the Thanksgiving of previous situations where God had gotten you out of it? To encourage you?
All that will encourage you. But Jehoshaphat, you remember that Jehoshaphat had his people first to what?
Fast
and pray. So that,
all of people,
that helps a whole lot too, right?
And
then after they fasted and prayed, then Jehoshaphat began to what? Pray the word. He began to remind God of all of his what? Promises. He said, Lord, when you said that whenever we came against enemies or pestilences or disease or war, famine, whatever, we were confronted, if we would just come and stand before this house and pray. That was the same prayer that Solomon prayed. He said, you said that you would hear us and you would what? You would help us. So Jehoshaphat was feeding God his same word. He was just giving it back the word that God had what? Promised in previous generations. And after that powerful prayer was prayed, then what happened, Jehoshaphat, in that congregation, somebody began to prophesy.
Yes.
How many remember the guy? Who's name? Jehaziel?
Jehaziel, the son of Zechariah.
He began to what? Prophesy.
Yes.
And his prophecy just mainly said that what?
Hearken ye, all Judah, and ye inhabitants of Jerusalem, mm-hmm. and thou King Jehoshaphat, mm-hmm. thus saith the Lord unto you, be not afraid nor dismayed, mm-hmm. for reason of this great multitude, mm-hmm. for the battle is not yours but God's.
Okay, so that was encouraging too. Okay.